The summer of 1950 started like most summers in the small town of Wytheville, Virginia. School let out, the town pools opened, and kids flocked to the soda fountain on Main Street. Almost 40% of the town's 5,500 residents were under the age of 18.
Wytheville was more or less a lazy type, laid-back town. Everyone knew everyone. It got really hot in the summertime, and we would go swimming. We were happy-go-lucky kids.
I had a pair of my grandfather's rubber boots on, and I was wading in the creek. And when I went to get out, I felt like something pulled in my leg. I went home and hadn't been home too long till I started running a temperature and was real nauseous and just kept going higher and higher.
I was outside playing. I just didn't feel right. By the time I got inside the house to my mother, I told her I was sick. I had a headache. I was so dizzy. And after that, I just passed out.
The doctor came to do a spinal tap on my brother, and he screamed. And my mother ran downstairs with a bed pillow, went out in the backyard and covered her head with a pillow, and laid there and screamed.
We only had two ambulance services in Wytheville. One would come in to the clinic with a suspected case, while the other one would be coming out of the clinic and leaving for either Roanoke or Richmond. In, out, in, out, in, out, in, out. Mr. Williams' tote board was right across the street from where I worked, and it was always visible. And every once in a while, we'd go to the front door and look out, and every time another one came in with diagnosis, well, they changed the count.
Daddy and Mama took everything Sonny owned. All of his clothes, his bed, his chest of drawers, and he had a fabulous comic book collection. And they took everything out to the middle of the garden, and they just made a pile and burned everything he owned. They were told to do that so that we would not get it.
Polio was hitting Wytheville hard, harder that year than any place in the country.
It became more and more evident that we were really in trouble. And without knowing what to do, or how to stop it, or how to get away from it, we were just stuck with it. You just couldn't pick up everybody and leave, and you couldn't set the whole town on fire. So it was almost, not hopeless, but it was getting pretty close that way.
Since the turn of the 20th century, polio, also known as infantile paralysis, had become an increasingly menacing fact of American life. Highly contagious, the polio virus tended to strike during the summer.
It was very reliable. Come June, July, you began to see cases of polio, and they continued on through September.
The symptoms ranged from a mild headache and nausea to muscle weakness, paralysis, or death.
One never knew how it would go. Would it pass through the body and the person would get up out of bed a few days later just fine? Would there be one leg damaged? Would both arms?
The paralytic effects would last for life. And you didn't have to look very far to see people who had been crippled with polio and crippled in terrible ways.
In 1921, The disease struck an especially prominent citizen, just as his political star was on the rise. Polio usually targeted children, but Franklin Delano Roosevelt was 39. After contracting a sudden fever and chills, he lost the use of both his legs.
FDR was an enormous landmark in the whole history of polio. The fact that he came down with polio changed the course of the disease in this country.
Roosevelt worked to restore both his body and his career. He bought a remote Georgia resort whose spring-fed baths were reputed to have healing powers and turned it into the Georgia Warm Springs Foundation, committed to rehabilitating polio patients from around the country. In 1928, a still paralyzed but vital FDR fought his way back onto the national political stage. To keep the fight against polio alive, Roosevelt turned to his law partner, Basil O'Connor, a man who knew little about polio, but a great deal about power and persuasion. "I was never a public do-gooder," O'Connor declared, "and had no aspirations of that kind." Short-tempered and relentless, he was a working-class Irishman who had to dig and fight for everything he had achieved.
Basil O'Connor has no interest in being the head of the Warm Springs Foundation, but he is so loyal to Franklin Roosevelt, and he really believes the only way to ensure FDR's political career is to take over this institution that is so close to FDR's heart.
With Roosevelt now in the White House, O'Connor worked tirelessly to keep the organization afloat. America was experiencing the worst economic depression in its history. Charity's traditional source of funding, donations from the rich, had completely dried up. Worse still, the number of cases of polio continued to rise.
What made polio so questionable, what made it so hard for people to get a grip on, was that at the very time America was becoming a cleaner, more antiseptic society, the polio rates were going up dramatically.
In time, scientists would unlock some of polio's mysteries. They would learn the virus entered the body through the mouth, that it passed from person to person through contaminated water, food, or physical contact. They would come to understand that modern sanitation actually helped explain the prevalence of the disease. Infants in clean environments were less likely to be exposed to the virus and develop lifelong immunity.
Before improvements in sanitation, all children were born with antibodies against polio. When we had improved sanitation, children started to become exposed to polio later and later in life, at a time when those antibodies they had received from their mother had already disappeared. And that's why you saw an emergence of the disease.
In 1938, O'Connor didn't know much about the science of polio. What he did know was that polio patients depended on private charities like his, not the government, for help. Without a new way to raise money, his foundation could offer little more than hope. It was time, he decided, to try something bold.